Every parent wants their child to be treated fairly, but many Hampton Roads school divisions have adopted very different policies against transgender student discrimination.
A law intended to provide protections to all students has instead led to inconsistent policies with no system for accountability. Investigative reporter Evan Watson takes a closer look.
So it's hard to be like, oh yay, we're finally going somewhere, when we're really not.
A new Virginia law required all schools to expand protections for transgender students by the start of this school year. The Virginia Department of Education crafted and shared model policies with school divisions. Only a handful of local school boards adopted them in full.
So when we know that and we're not implementing policies uniformly, then it's going to defeat the purpose of having them at all.
Three local school divisions, Virginia Beach, Portsmouth, and Newport News, ultimately accepted the VDOE recommendations. At least eight other school divisions in Hampton Roads decided to take their own routes, either making partial revisions, deciding their own policies are good enough, or in some cases, simply adding the phrase gender identity to their non-discrimination policies. The law requires school boards to adopt policies that are at least consistent with, if not more comprehensive, than the VDOE suggestions. But there's currently no way for state leaders to enforce that. Isle of Wight school board members, for example, pushed back against the VDOE recommendations, instead making minor tweaks.
We are going to follow the law. I just don't want to be attached to the nonsense that I have read in the other part of the VDOE recommendations.
It did not say it was mandatory, okay? It's a recommendation.
V. Pritchard, a transgender and non-binary student, said the VDOE model policies include specific recommendations for a reason.
If it's vague and it's not direct and to the point of exactly what's going to happen and exactly how you're going to handle it, it's not going to do anything and it's just going to kind of fall on blank ears.
The Chesapeake School Board added some of the recommended changes, including a gender-neutral dress code and allowing students to use names and pronouns they prefer. But Chesapeake stopped short of defining restroom policies, as state leaders did.
Obviously, that was provided as a guide, but school divisions developed their own policies to be in compliance with those as much as possible. We are not going to tolerate any harassment or discrimination of any student.
With inconsistent policies, I asked the Department of Education how it's keeping track. The short answer, it's not. The law doesn't require school boards to report their policies to the state, so that means transgender students likely have very different protections based on where they live.
There are so many trans children that are suicidal. There are so many young kids that don't understand yet and are hurting. And these policies could possibly save their lives, and not enforcing them is doing the opposite.
In July, State Superintendent James Lane sent this memo to school divisions, saying local school boards that elect not to adopt policies assume all legal responsibility for non-compliance. But that would mean families would need to sue school divisions for change, which doesn't sit well with advocates.
That's not okay at all. And who has the resources and the time and the ability to do that?
V. Pritchard says inconsistent policies with little accountability creates a bigger divide for students like them. Some school systems now have detailed policies with specific protections, and others have a simple anti-discrimination statement.
It's just going to keep happening. People are just going to keep being bullied. They're going to keep hurting. And it's just a really horrible situation.
Evan Watson, reporting for 13 News Now.